Get started. You have your handout, fervency and boldness. For devotion, we'll just read the first page for devotion. Fervency and holiness. Fervency and boldness. In worship and in prayer. Everybody have that one? Psalms 5 and 11, the first quick, everybody got that? Everybody read one, Psalms 5 and 11, we'll start with the head table over here.
Where's the head table?
The head talking to.
That's over there.
Ladies first, he's saying ladies first.
Right there, Pastor.
I didn't hear ladies first.
I'm just coming for it.
Psalms 5:11. But let all those that put their trust in thee rejoice. Let them ever shout for joy, because thou defendest them. Let them also that love thy name be joyful in thee.
All right, what does that mean to you?
Rejoice and be glad. Yes, be. And because why? Because we love thy name.
And he defended us. Mm-hmm. Right.
Shout for joy.
And all of those that put their trust in thee rejoice. Let them ever shout for joy, because thou defendest them. Okay, why do you think it's necessary to ever shout? Ever shout for joy.
Well, when you
let
shout.
Them ever shout for joy.
When you shout for joy, you shout. You're putting forth an effort. Mm-hmm. And
gladness.
Yes. Put forth an effort.
And when you shout, you're also showing where your trust is.
That's right.
Who you believe in.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And who you're thankful of. Mm-hmm.
All right. We're reading the first page of fervency and boldness. Just read that for devotional purpose. But let all of those that put their trust in thee rejoice, let them ever shout for joy, because thou defendest them. Let them also that love thy name be joyful in thee. Okay, there is a Hebrew word that means to shout aloud, Shabbat, a loud adoration, a shout proclaiming with a loud voice, unashamed of glory, triumph, power, mercy, love of God. All right. The phrase shout unto the Lord can be understood as an action of Shabbat. So God loves loud adoration. Why do you believe God loves loud adorations?
We love. We love adoration. You know, if someone say, you give a person something, and they say, oh, thank you, I appreciate it. You know, it's like, okay, they really do. But if they say, oh, thank you, I really, really appreciate this. This is so nice. It's just a, you, well, for me, you feel like they appreciate it more, and there's more expression. There's more expression.
All right, what effect do you think a loud adoration has on your flesh?
It gives you release.
All right. Everybody agree? Helps to break through the hindrances and the forces that's opposing you. And we are consistently challenged with, does the believer consistently have opposition? Opposition in this world? Okay, in what area? Mind, spirit, body?
All of the above.
Okay, what?
Emotional, spiritual, physical.
What's opposing the believer?
What?
What is our opposition? What is our opposition? What is it? Forces of what?
Darkness.
Our opposition, we have forces of darkness, enemy.
Consistently.
And also sometimes ourselves.
Okay. What is the area that Satan attacks most?
Mind.
Okay, they call it the battlefield of the mind. Okay, so what can we do to protect our minds?
Stay in the word of God.
What can we do to do? What was that word to use? To protect.
Protect.
Oh, protect. Guard.
Eat the word.
The word said guard. Guard. Well, we have to guard our minds. With the word.
So if we open our mouths, we can counteract the attacks that come against our minds. Is that right? All right, I was wondering why the Bible always admonishes us to ever shout for joy. Ever shout for joy, because I think that if we want to walk in victory, Satan is consistently trying to attack us and to keep us, hinder us from carrying out the will of God. Think that the devil backs down when you stand up to it?
Well, the word says, resist him and he'll flee.
All right.
You have to submit yourself to God.
You have to resist him, what? Steadfast.
In the faith, but you have to resist him with the word, like Jesus. Full of word.
All right, so one way to resist the devil is to what?
And James says, submit yourself to
the word.
Praise.
Giving us thanks is another.
All right. All right. Philippians 1:28. That's a good scripture. And in nothing terrified by your adversaries, which is to them an evident token of prediction, but to you of salvation and that of God. So I think that when we ever shout to the Lord, that's a good way to release our faith and get Satan to back down. And that terrifies, amen, put fear and cause the enemy to what? Get confused to back down. So we just want to know all of the different avenues and all of the different weapons that we have against the enemy. All right, can anybody just off the top of your head name some of the Bible says the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are what? Mighty through God. All right, now what are the weapons that we normally refer to when we say the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God? What weapons does the believer has to come against the enemy? I guess they are offensive weapons and defensive weapons, but we got some powerful weapons. And what some of the weapons that we have?
Yeah, the word first.
All right. Everybody say the believer word is the weapon.
Yes. Love of Jesus.
Right.
faith is a weapon.
Yes, faith is a weapon.
Sure is.
All right, name some more.
Praise.
All right, praise. All right, give me an example of some of these, where the word is has been a weapon. Somebody used the word and got victory. An example.
How about Colossians 3?
You want
a scripture?
A contemporary example of what?
It doesn't matter. Well, give me an incident in the scripture where the word was used and victory was wrought.
When Jesus was tempted by the enemy, the devil, he used word.
Sure did.
Jesus used the word. What did he say?
It is written. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It is written.
So what effect did that have on the enemy?
Well, at first, not a whole lot, because he kept coming back. But he was steadfast in what he said. But by being steadfast, the enemy finally left. So I think that was an example for us, that if we just initially use the word and the enemy doesn't flee from us, then we can look at that example and see that Jesus was steadfast in it. Mm-hmm. There were, I believe, 3 times he approached it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, give me another illustration. Anybody have an illustration of Daniel? Let's look at Daniel. What weapon did Daniel use to get his answer?
Prayer.
All right. What weapon did Daniel use?
Was it prayer?
Okay. What kind of prayer did Daniel use?
Fervent prayer.
Well, intercession.
Prayer of what?
Fervency.
Was it prayer of supplication?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So, did Daniel get his answer immediately?
No.
All right. He had to do what?
Persisted.
He had to what? Persist, right? Yeah. All right, he had to continue to what? To press in. And did the answer come?
It did, yes.
Okay, so prayer is a powerful weapon as well, right?
Yes.
And just the spoken word is a what? Powerful weapon. But in all of these weapons that we have to be persistent, right?
Yes.
Right? Trying to get the scripture that said that we have to resist, steadfast. Okay, this is 1 Peter 5:8-9. This is page 18 in your handout. Page 17. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. All right, so somebody said, if the devil ain't bound, must be tied with a mighty long chain. Because everywhere you go, he's what? He's doing his job. He's on his job. He's busy. But the scripture says, home, resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same affliction are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. So you have to be very persistent, even in standing in faith for things like your healing. You have to be very persistent. Someone said God votes for you, the devil votes against you, and how you cast your vote determines the outcome.
All right, so those are weapons that we have against the enemy. Sister Hill started out reading for our devotion, Psalms 5:11. But let all of those that put their trust in thee rejoice, let them ever shout for joy, because thou defendest them. Now the words...
The words that came in late, you might want to tell them where we are.
Yeah, we were just doing some devotional things.
From fervency.
Page one on fervency and boldness and worship and in prayer, we were just doing some devotional scriptures. And we started out with Psalms 5:11, but let all of those that put their trust in thee rejoice, let them ever shout for joy. The word shout for joy could be the word Shabbat, a loud adoration. That is a word for praise. And praise is a weapon that we can use against the enemy. All right? There's a lot of different forms of praise that we can use against the enemy. Shabbat is one that gets tremendous results. Shouting, shouting, shouting gets tremendous results. When opposed by the enemy. When we are opposed by the enemy, okay. Anybody can remember in the Bible where people just shouted and got victory?
Joshua,
the battle of
Jericho,
Jericho.
They shouted.
Anybody remember in the Old Testament or New Testament?
Joshua's
army.
In the New
Testament, when Paul and Silas were in prison, and they shouted, saying.
All right, Paul and Silas was in prison, and they. I don't think the word shout. They said that they lifted their voices and the prisoners heard. The prisoners heard them. So they had to do it kind of loud. And what happened as the result of them lifting their voices and praising the Lord? What happened? That the foundation of the prison was what?
Shaken.
Amen. Can you imagine? You have to do some praising to shake the foundation. He doesn't have to have the word shout in there. If you're going to shake the foundation of the prison, I mean, it's got to be what? It's got to be some what? Amen.
It's got to be audible enough.
So what?
It's got to be audible enough to hear.
Okay.
For somebody else to hear.
All right.
At least.
All right, what happened there? I mean, it was a lot of miraculous things that happened as a result of that shout. What all happened to Paul and Silas in that prison? What happened?
They got
the door
opened. The Lord opened. The
Lord stopped the doors. And
people and salvation came.
Eventually, yeah, the guard got saved.
Well, that was a lot of miracles.
Yes.
So that's enough motivation for us to what? Open our mouths and what? Just see what shouting will do. Okay, somebody was saved, baptized. I mean, there's a whole lot of things happening in Acts 16. As a result of, Sister Hill started it out, I was just challenging her, let them ever shout for joy, because thou defendest them. And all of those that love thy, let all of those that love thy name be what? Joyful in thee. So that is what you're trying to cultivate. Amen. We're doing a whole lot of back and forth stuff, but I'm just after some joy. I'm after some excitement. I think that when God's people get excited enough, I think things will begin to what? Happen. Amen. So that was Acts 16, Sister Denise, you get a chance in a minute. I'm just going to check that out because that was kind of quick. Midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them, and suddenly there was a great earthquake so that the foundations of that prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's bands were loosed. Whoa. And the keeper of the prison awakened out of his sleep, and seeing the prisoner door open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. But Paul cried with a soft voice. Paul cried with a what? Loud voice, saying, "Do thyself no harm, for we are all here." All right, Paul shouted out real loud, didn't he? Then he called for a light, sprang in, and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And they said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, thou shalt be saved, and thy house." And they spake unto him the word of the Lord and to all that were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night and washed their stripes and was baptized, he and all of his straightway. And when he had brought them into his house, he set meat before them and rejoiced, believing in God with all of his house. And when it was day, the magistrates sent the sergeant, saying, "Let those men go." Amen. That is amazing. But when we read these scriptures like this, it's good to kind of have a storyline to refer to show the virtue of what the scripture is asking us to do. I think that was a good illustration in Acts 16 where they shouted for joy and God intervened and God dealt with those forces that we just mentioned. God ministered and released his power. Okay, so shouting for joy is a huge weapon. That is a weapon that we call praise, Shabbat, a loud adoration. And that you can find in your words for praise, your words for Shabbat. If you have that word, Shabbat is on page 17 under your words for praise, Hebrew words for praise. Shabbat means a loud adoration, a shout proclaiming with a loud voice, unashamed, the glory, triumph, power, mercy, love of God. Okay, now if you look under all of the words for praise under Shabbat, you will find a lot of the words that we use commonly, like, "Because thy loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall Shabbat thee." My lips shall Shabbat thee. And if you go through all of the words for Shabbat, you will see that a lot of the words that we the one that Sister Hill just read, Psalms 5:11, "But let all of those that put their trust in thee rejoice, let them ever shout or Shabbat for joy. Because thou defendest them, let them also that love thy name be joyful in thee." That's Psalms 5:11. That word is Shabbat. Psalms 32:11, the next word on the fervency and boldness, the second Psalms 32:11, "Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, ye righteous," and what? Shout for joy, all ye that are what? Upright in heart. All right, be glad in the Lord and rejoice, ye righteous, and what? Shabbat. All right, so
That's amazing how God is admonishing us to lift up our voices and what? And shout. Shout to him with the voice of triumph. Okay, so Joshua's was another case in which victory was wrought through what? A loud adoration. How many remember Jesus at the gravesite of Lazarus? Okay, let me see. We have that one in the handout. Page 2. Okay. Yeah, on page 2. All right, let's look at page 2. We're just looking at some words here that when it says shout, kind of gets my attention. Jesus said unto her, page 2 and page 3, Lazarus raised from the dead. Jesus saith unto her, said I not unto thee that if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldest see the glory of God? Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me, and I knew that thou hearest me always, but because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. And when he thus had spoken, he cried with a loud voice. What did he cry? Lazarus, what? And he that was what? Dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. Jesus said unto them, loose him. Jesus was speaking to the grave clothes. Loose him and what?
Let him go.
Okay, so Jesus shouted with a what? Loud voice. All right. So all of those scriptures, now when we read over those scriptures, you don't have a storyline to refer that to. It's not going to be that meaningful. We're just going to read it. We'll read over them, and we won't think, you know, we won't even think about, we won't even think, you know, to even lift our voice. So, you know, sometimes we just get too casual and get too comfortable with being what? Casual. And so we need something to kind of shake us up. And these loud adorations will kind of get your soul attention. Get your attention. I mean, these three parts of us that have to respond to the, amen, to the word. Amen. The spirit, soul, and body. All right, so we see the virtue of shouting. So it gives it, all of these scriptures on page 1, it gives it a lot more meaning when you can refer to a lot of the storylines and you can see what was wrought as a result of them shouting out or shabbaking to the Lord. So I just wanted to call your attention to that. Maybe there's one more we can just use.
I got one for Pastor.
Okay.
I got one. It doesn't actually say shout, but when you read it, you get the impression that they shouted. And that's okay. In Acts 3:6.
Alright, Acts 3:6.
Okay. They showed it, say it up under their breath, I know that.
Alright, look, Acts 3:6, what does that say?
You want to read?
Uh-huh.
Then Peter said, silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. Mm-hmm. Which is all a weapon.
Right. Alright. So that was I don't think that was spoken well. No,
whether meekly or not, I think it's very loud and determined.
All right. All right. Now, so that's a good illustration. And following that, I like
Now that man got up and walked. The scripture says in Acts 3:16, in his name, well, Jesus gave, I mean, Peter preached a little bit. He began to relate the how they had killed the Prince of Life whom God had raised from the dead, whereof we are witnesses. This is patient. This is verse 15. In his name, through faith in his name, had made this man strong, whom you see and know, yea, the faith which is by him, had given this man perfect soundness in the presence of you all. And if you go to chapter 4 and 10, it says, be it known unto you all and to all of the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ.
You're reading
Christ,
where now?
Acts 4:10.
Be it known unto you all and to all of the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him does this man stand here before you hold. Now, let's keep on reading. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Now when they saw the what? Boldness of Peter and John, so that let you know that they were very, very bold. They weren't timid, weak, kneed, and jellyback. Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled and they took knowledge of them that they had what? Been with Jesus. All right. Now, verse 18, let's keep on reading. I'm just giving what Brother Donaldson said this because that was on my heart all day, like yesterday too. They called them and commanded them not to speak at all, nor teach in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John answered and said unto them, whether it be right in the sight of God to hearken unto you more than God, judge ye. For we cannot but speak the things which we have what?
Seen and heard.
Which we have what? Seen and heard.
Seen and heard.
And they just kept on. So when they had further threatened them, they let them go, finding nothing how they might punish them because of the people. For all men glorified God for that which was done. That was the same incident in which the lame man was what? Was healed. Now let's keep on reading.
Yeah.
For the man was above 40 years old, on whom this miracle of healing was shown. And being let go, they went to their own company and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said unto them. Verse 24, and when they heard that, they did what?
They
lifted up their what?
Voice
to God with what?
One
accord. And said, Lord, thou art God, which has made heaven and earth and the sea and all that in them is. All right. Who by the mouth of thy servant David has said, why did the heathen rage and the people imagine vain things? The kings of the earth stood up. The rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. For truth against thy holy child Jesus, whom thou hast anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, which with the Gentiles and the people of Israel were gathered together, for to do whatsoever they thy hand and thy counsel determined before to be done. And now, Lord, behold thy threatenings, and grant unto thy servants that with all boldness they may what?
Speak
thy word. By stretching forth thine hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be
done by the name of the Holy Child Jesus. And when they had prayed, the place was what? Shaken, where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with what?
Boldness.
And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul, neither said any of them that aught of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all things common, and with great power, everybody said with great power, gave the apostles what? Witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them. All right, might make you happy, man. All right, now when find that scripture, Peter and John, somewhere in here, said, we must obey God rather than man. Next chapter. Then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, let's do 28. Saying, did not we straightly? This is after they were released from prison by the angel, is that right? And when they had brought them, they set them before the council, and the high priest asked them, saying, did not we straightly command you that ye should not teach in this name? And behold, you have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine, and intend to bring this man's blood upon us. Then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey what?
God
rather than man. So they were pretty bold. Amen. They were pretty bold. Amen. Okay, now I'm just going to turn to chapter 6 just to give you a little bit more insight. And in those days, when the number of the disciples was multiplied, there arose a murmuring of the Grecians among the Hebrews, because their widows were neglected in the daily menstruation. Then the 12 called the multitude of the disciples unto them and said, it is not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you seven men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, and whom we may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. And the saying pleased the whole multitude, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost, and Philip, and Prosotis, Prosperus, and Nicanor, and Timon, and Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch, whom they set before the apostles. And when they had prayed, they laid their hands on them, and the word of God increased, and the number of the disciples multiplied in Jerusalem greatly, and a great company of the priests were obedient to the faith. And Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. Verse 10, and they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he spake. This kind of shows you the extent that they were filled with the
Holy Ghost. They were full of Holy Ghost, full of wisdom, full of power, full of the anointing, and they were bold men. Amen. You can go all through the book of Acts and you'll find a lot of similar. I'll just read one more. This is Acts 11. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number believed and turned unto the Lord. Then tidings of these things came unto the ears of the church which was in Jerusalem, and they sent forth Barnabas that he should go as far as Antioch. But when he came and had seen the grace of God, was glad and exhorted them all, that with purpose of heart they should cleave unto the Lord. For he was a good man, and full of the Holy Ghost and of faith, and much people was added unto the Lord. All right, so it seems like if you really want to see some action, we just have to be what? Get full, refilled with what? The Holy Ghost. Full of faith, full of wisdom, full of the Holy Ghost, and you'll see signs and wonders in the supernatural. Okay, so thought I would just read some of those scriptures, because when we read these scriptures on the first page, if you know some of the stories behind them, you can see why it's important, why we should be excited, and what we can experience when we let go and let God have his way. Amen. All right, we just want to spend a few minutes in going over some of the scriptures. Now, we just finished these and we'll move on. Psalms 35:27, let them shout for joy and be glad that favor my righteous cause. Everybody with me?
Yeah.
Yea, let them say continually, let the Lord be which hath pleasure. All right, now these are scriptures that we need to be shouting out. We gotta get some excitement, we gotta get some boldness, we gotta get some fire in our bones. And y'all just mentioned that one of the weapons we have is the word of God in our mouths. So let the Lord be magnified, which hath pleasure in the prosperity of his service. Let them shout for joy and be glad that favor my righteous cause. All right, how many in here favor his righteous cause?
Amen.
How many on God's side?
Amen.
How many on the devil's side? There's some noise there too. There's some response. All right, now, what would happen, Brother Holman, if you just shouted out real loud and proudly, let the Lord be magnified?
He scares the savior.
Really, that one was wrong.
How many got enough boldness to lift your voice? I mean, that gives you a huge release when you can just open up. Do you feel better? Is that right?
Yes, it does.
Put you in a mode where your spirit, soul, and body can what? Unite and really begin to praise God with your whole heart. It just sets a whole lot of positive things in motion. So we just don't want to back down and be quiet and soft and be timid. We need a jelly back. Amen. We got to generate some joy. How many can say amen?
Amen.
All right, let's go further. Let all of those that seek thee rejoice and be what? Glad in thee. Let such as love thy salvation say continually,
the Lord be magnified.
God wants to be what? Magnified. He wants to be what? Magnified. All through the book of Acts, you said, and the people glorified the God, the Lord of, the God of Israel. They glorified the God of Israel. They magnified the Lord. When they saw the works of the Lord, they what? Magnified him. Amen. The Bible says, let us sacrifice with the sacrifice of what? Thanksgiving. Let us declare his works with rejoicing. Amen. Praise God. All right. Hallelujah. Let's do Psalms 47:1. Maybe we can clap our hands better than we can lift up our voices. Oh, clap your hands, all of the people. Shout out to God with a voice of triumph. All right. That one also exhorted us to what? Shout out to God. All right.
Right. We didn't have drums and all the
instruments. We had our hands. That's what we were taught to do.
That's what we were taught to do.
All right. Praise the Lord. Psalms 55:17. Everybody together. Evening and morning and anew will I pray and cry aloud. Evening and morning and at noon. And these three times a day, we ought to be able to, what, to get a good shout out. Get a good shout in. Amen. And he shall hear my voice. All right, it's kind of tied with the fervent, the effectual fervent prayer. It seems like that we can release more of ourselves when we what? Lift our voices. All right. Psalms 98:4, let's do that one together. It says what?
Make the joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Make a loud noise and rejoice and sing praise.
All right, make a loud noise and rejoice and what?
Sing praise.
Woo, glory. Hallelujah. All right. Now, you ought to hear some of these people in the morning. They be shouting these things out loud. And if anybody not with the program, man, they kind of what? You put some fire in them. Make a loud noise and rejoice. Amen. We definitely could use that on Sunday morning. All right, so we're going to have to put some of these in operation so people can be reminded that they need to what? Make a loud noise and rejoice. Okay, Psalms 132:9 says what? Let the praise be Lord with righteousness,
and let the saints shout for joy.
All right. Oh, my God. Let the saints what?
Shout for joy.
All right. We don't expect the ants to shout, but the saints ought to what? Shout. Let the priest be clothed with righteousness, and let the saints shout. All right. Isaiah 12:6, what does that say?
Cry out and shout, thou inhabitant of Zion.
For great is the Holy One of Israel in the midst of thee. All right, so those are some powerful scriptures. And you have illustrations all through the following pages. Jehoshaphat and the children of Judah. Priests and the Levites. That was very interesting in 2 Chronicles 5:13. Let's read that. And it came to pass, as the trumpeters and singers were as one to make one sound to be heard in praises and thanking the Lord. And when they lifted up their voices with the trumpets and cymbals and instruments of music, and praise the Lord, saying, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Let the people in the house fill with the cloud,
even the house of the Lord.
So that the priest could not stand to minister
by reason of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord has filled the house of God.
Glory. Hey, shut up. Spirit that they did it in. Praise the Lord for his
mercy endures forever.
Okay.
Praise the Lord for his mercy endures forever.
Sister Wayne giving us some of that pep. That pep pray that she does on Tuesdays and Thursdays. Say it again, Sister Wayne. Say it.
Praise the Lord for his mercy endureth forever.
Yes.
Praise the Lord for his mercy endureth forever.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father, for your mercy.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father, for your grace. Thank you, Lord.
Forever.
Thank you.
They said they did it with a loud voice.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Thank you,
Lord. All right. So what?
You know, when you're in like a stadium or and something happens and everybody at the same
Lord.
Yeah.
It seems like the building is going to raise.
Favorite team make that touchdown.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's read the other one, the last one. And when they
began
to sing and to praise the Lord,
the Lord
against
his children and all that happened when they began to sing and praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
I was looking to see if I could find that last word for praise when they began to sing and to praise the Lord. If that was under the scripture, under the word Tehillah, praise. I was looking to see if Tehillah praise might be the word for praise in that particular scripture. See if you can find page 27 of your words for praise under the Hebrew words. Tehillah praise. All right, if that word is Tehillah, then that is a very powerful way of praise. It's not just an ordinary praise that they render. All right, anybody see that under Tehillah?
Yes.
All right, on page 27, 2 Chronicles 20:22, and when they begin to sing and to praise the Lord, the Lord said, it's under Tehillah. And what does Tehillah mean? To sing Hallel. A hymn of what?
Spontaneous
praise. Glorifying God in song. The total empowerment of oneself in worship unto God.
It is the praise that we know God enhances.
Translated only as praise in King things to earth. All right, so what kind of praise is that?
Wow.
That is what? Spontaneous praise. A total involvement of oneself in worship. All right, that's the type of praise that calls God to set ambushment against the enemies. All right, can we lift up our voices and do that praise? That calls for a spontaneous what? Song. Y'all see that?
Yeah.
That calls for a spontaneous what? Song.
Praise. Yes.
All right. Y'all want to work on that one? Y'all want to work on that one or do it now?
Hallelujah. 하늘옵다. 예 바보시 예 다세고 무로한데 기한데 오메
예 데스키 도스카라 디스카 도 코르바디 오 리비디와 오시라 데미시 기사라 도로바시 13, we're going to just call your attention to these so we can admonitions and declarations. We will boldly speak forth to shake up the saints and release God's power in us. All right, admonitions and declarations. This is kingdom power declarations. You can always add scriptures. I've already added some more. But these are scriptures that shows that the kingdom of God is on the inside of us, and God has made a huge deposit in us, and we ought to just be excited about what God has placed within us. And I was at the hospital today, and I was beginning to read an In Him book to the patient that was there, and that was very, I began to relate some of that. That's very good. All of these confessions and declarations and affirmations, we want to just continue to declare them and affirm them. We have our kingdom declarations. We have Mary heart declaration. Amen. You haven't got a Mary heart? Yeah, we haven't even started on Mary heart. All right. We have quickened our main sister. Do you have all these? You don't have none of these?
I don't have
any. You have the ones, fervency. Oh, you don't have them.
Okay.
Fervency and boldness.
Oh, yeah, I do have fervency and boldness and worship and in prayer.
Yes.
Okay, well, I'm glad you have that. I was just thinking that we've done all of this and you didn't have none of these.
Pastor, before you go, I know we only got about 5 minutes, but the scripture we just read before we went up in praise in Chronicles, 2 Chronicles, I was reflecting back on that, all of this, in these verses here, and when they began to sing praises, the Lord sent ambushment. Mm-hmm. They have been given a promise. Back in verse 15, and when the Lord said, thus said, that this is the latter part of chapter 20, verse 15, the part B, be not afraid nor dismayed by reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's. And they had, that was something to shout about.
Amen.
When all that great army coming against it, but the Lord has said, the battle is not yours. You're not going to have to fight this, but it's the Lord's battle. And then what did they begin to do? Just begin to sing and praise and shout.
Hallelujah.
And then it's an ambushment against it, but the battle, but that was a promise they had, that this battle is not yours.
It's hallelujah.
It's good to read the whole chapter.
Yes. Yeah. The battle is not yours.
Hallelujah. All right, but I the ones that really
yes, it is. That was for me here.
The Mary Heart Declaration, you'll find some really nuggets in that one. And also, like, be bold, and fear not. The bold declarations, those are some very powerful ones too. And we just wanted you to keep affirming them. I believe revival will break out among us.
Okay, just one more thing.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay, and we were talking about the Shabbat, the the scriptures on to worship the ones that we went on page one. I remember, I was just thinking about all the ones with shouting, be magnified and loud adoration and all. Some of the old timers in here remember years ago, there used to be a product, I don't know if it's still on the market or not, it's called Shout. And they would demonstrate, Brother Sonny remember, he's like, okay, to demonstrate that they had used other things and it hadn't quite cleared it up. And all they did was spray a little of that Shout on there and it got it out. And I thought, okay, they had tried some other things and that didn't work. But they put that Shout out on and that Shout just disappeared. That's what shouting will do for us in the Word. We've tried other things and all, but then shouting, you know, shouting. Of course, you've got to have the Word in us, you know, to do it. Shouting otherwise, if you don't have the Word, it's just making a lot of noise. But when you got the Word in you and you know what promises He's made, then you can shout that thing out. Ooh, glory to God.
Yes. Hallelujah. Well, can we have some dancing in the house?
Yes,
I'm a dancing king over there. He said, yeah, man.
Hallelujah.
Glory. Amen. Just get to my feet now. Just get fuller than my mouth. Get to my feet. You better wake up, Appalachians. Sing a new song, Appalachian. And we got some more Appalachians or affirmation, might want to call them affirmations. The weapons of mass destruction, affirmations, those are the heavyweight weapons, and we have a variety of weapons. All right, but we just kind of went to. You know, I'm not just going to get locked into one thing. I'm looking for a breakthrough and a revival, the Spirit of God working and something happening. Amen.
Praise God.
Amen. Praise God. We just thank God for the Word tonight, and I think that we don't waste time when we spend the time on the Word, affirming the Word.
Amen.
Amen. All right, we're going to close out. We've already prayed.